Hello, good morning. Today our guest is Professor Diego Comin. Hello, Diego Comin. How are you doing?
Very well, Ibtan. How are you?
I'm great. So, Diego, tell us a little about yourself. Where do you teach? And what do you teach?
I teach macroeconomics at Dartmouth College in New Hampshire.
And you teach macroeconomics at Dartmouth College in New Hampshire, and you have done some fascinating studies on the diffusion of technology.
Thank you.
Yes, so, yeah, you're a bit modest. I was expecting you to talk a little bit more about that research, but that's what we're going to do now. Some years ago, you wrote a paper. I think it's quite path-breaking. It is called, Was the Wealth of Nations Determined in 1000 BC? What is this paper all about?
So this is a joint work with Bill Easterly and Eric Gong, who are two great economists. We work together to do a number of things related to technology diffusion. So we wanted to, at a very high level, get a sense of how much current development outcomes are determined by things that are recent versus factors that are historical that were determined in the distant past. And in a way, the motivation for that agenda was that policymakers and study development, they think that by quickly tweaking a few elements here and there, okay? While if in reality the current development of nations is driven by factors that were determined in the distant past, then that way of portraying development that we identified was, you know, it's incorrect. It's not going to really lead to development. It's just going to lead to fruitless policy changes. Okay, so that was at a high level the motivation for the paper. Now, what we try to do is to first come out with measures of technology adoption that reflected how sophisticated the technologies used for production were in the distant past in territories that map into today's countries. Okay, so many of today's countries haven't existed for a long time. So we wanted to analyze the equivalent to today's countries and look at the levels of sophistication of technology. And then we wanted to see to which extent there was some persistence in the levels of technology that we saw when comparing the technologies that these civilizations that inhabited territories in the distant past had relative to the technologies that we have today in the same territories. That was at a high level the objective of the paper.
Yes, and Diego, when your paper is first published, it created quite a storm because you're basically saying that the adoption of Asian technologies is linked to modern levels of economic development.
That's correct.
Yeah,
that's correct.
So, yeah, this is the point you're making.
That's correct. So, you know, again, in trying to see to which extent current development is determined by current policy changes versus by historical realities, what we did was to measure the level of technology in various ways that civilizations had in 1000 BC, in 0, and in 1500 AD. Okay, so this is like a bit more than 500 years ago.
So Diego, are these countries more developed today because adopting technologies in the past increased the institutional exposure to innovation?
Well, that's a very specific channel. We find evidence consistent with that or with things similar to that. So, I mean, you're jumping into the end of the paper, but yeah, in a way, what we find is evidence first of lots of historical persistence in adoption patterns, that is, places that were sophisticated from a technological standpoint in 1500 AD are also sophisticated from a technological standpoint today. We also saw lots of persistence between, say, 1000 BC and 1500 AD. And very importantly, what we found was that persistence, that historical persistence, it's enhanced dramatically when instead of looking at the technologies that countries had in a given geography, we look at the technologies that existed in the geographies that eventually populated a country. So for example, if you look at the US and you think that, like, you know, 50% of current American population, for example, just to make up a number, has a Western European descent, then what we look is we look at the technological level of the US and we coded it as being 50% of it driven or determined or equivalent to the technological sophistication in 1500 AD in Western Europe, okay? So we were much more careful than that. But when you look at these migration-adjusted measures of technology, of ancient technology, we found that was really extremely persistent, okay? Now, what does that mean in terms of the channels that drive development? There are various possible interpretations. One interpretation is that there is something that is very persistent that drove ancient technology and that also drives current development, okay? You could call this that could be climatic factors, or it could be institutions, or it could be population size. I mean, these are things that are quite persistent, some more than others. Institutions are not as persistent as climate or as persistent as population, but they certainly affect technology adoption patterns in the past and in the future. So that could be one possibility.
Yes, and this would have a long-term impact because exposure to technology would affect the ability to innovate and implement new technologies.
Yes, so I think the second hypothesis, I think is more connected to that. It's the second hypothesis that really what is persistent is not an omitted variable, but technology itself is what generates some path dependence, okay? And so here the idea was that if you have lots of technology in 1500 of certain sector, for example, lots of agricultural technologies that are in the frontier, then you will create certain institutions that will train workers to use those technologies, for example, schools, agricultural schools, okay? And you will create maybe newer technologies to improve on the existing ones because you already have the know-how on how to utilize the current technologies. So that's going to create lots of path dependence, lots of persistence in the... Okay. Now, that's a different hypothesis than the first one. The first one is not technology itself, what is persistence. Is technology reacts to something that is persistent, which is not technology itself. Now, in the paper, we have a way to tell those two stories apart, which has to do with the fact that this second hypothesis, the persistence is at the sector level, okay? So you can look at deviations in technology in one sector in a country relative to the average in the country, and that should still be persistent. While in the first one, once you remove the country effects, then there is no reason for it to be persistent because most of the things that generate persistence that are not technology itself are going to be common to the different sectors. And so we find that this persistence of technology due to the transmission of technological knowledge seems to be more important in explaining our findings. And that's the main takeaway from that paper, which is, I think, very closely related to the hypothesis you were posting, Lipton.
Yes, Diego, I would love to see a paper documenting the relationship between civilizational history and modern development. So there have been several papers charting the relationship between state history and modern development, but I think that state history is a function of civilizational history. So civilizations were more likely to create states. So maybe the link is between civilizational complexity and modern income and not so much state history. What do you think?
Yes. Well, as I said, like, you know, I think you're right that institutions, political institutions, evolve along the ways of technological factors. Okay.
Yeah. Diego?
To tell apart which yes, sorry, can you hear me?
No, you not for a minute I was unable to hear you, so you just may repeat yourself, please.
You know, two-way relationships between political institutions, if that's what you mean, you know, the state and civilization factors or technological factors, okay? There is lots of anecdotal evidence of how political institutions deter the diffusion of certain technologies when those are not, relevant or beneficial for the incumbent powers. There is also institutions that are enhanced with the development of when technology is developed, the size of the pie becomes bigger, and that leads to certain institutions that tend to protect better property rights, for example. So I'm not trying to create a huge horse race between or a full-blown horse race between institutions and technologies in this paper, but what we document in the paper is that to a large extent, this persistence that we see in the data when it comes to technological factors occurs at the sectorial level, okay? And so that means that to the extent that institutions have a symmetric effect or relatively symmetric effect on the adoption of technologies in different sectors, that is not what is driving the persistence that we see in the data. And so that's an econometric argument. It's not an intuitive argument, but it's one that allows us to tell apart these two hypotheses.
All right. And Diego, I would love for you to tell us a little about the CHAT data set.
Yes. So the CHAT data set is a different data set. So, you know, let me just step one second. Technology is very important for many things in economics. It's important to understand development. It's important to understand business cycles. It's important in and of itself. Okay. However, we economists have had, despite this importance, we have had relatively little success in measuring technology in a massive scale. Okay. We have struggled to come up with comprehensive measures of technology. And so many years ago, when I was starting in this profession, I was fully aware of that, of this asymmetry between the importance of technology and the availability of comprehensive data that would tell us something about the diffusion of technology. And so together with co-author Bart Hovind, who is a professor at the University, Arizona State University, We put together in various vintages at the end a big data set that cover the diffusion of around 100 technologies for around 150 countries over the last 200 years, okay? And so the data is not asymmetric, you know, you don't have like a comprehensive coverage of all of these technologies in all of these countries in all of these years, but at least it gives you material to study patterns of diffusion of technologies in different periods of time in very different types of countries. And that's what this chat, so.
All right, and the chat data set, did you amass information on Latin America?
Well, yeah, chat covers many, many countries. It covers, in principle, the ambition was to cover as many countries as possible. So out of these 150, we have said, we have many Latin American countries, yes.
Okay, because I'm interested in the, this has not been studied as yet, but I am interested in the innovation gap between Latin America and Africa. And I would love to know if it's linked to Latin America's early adoption of some technologies.
Yeah. So we, one thing in the first paper that you mentioned, the one with Eric Gong and Bill Easterleon, was the Wealth of Nations determining 1000 BC. One of the things that we study carefully, relatively carefully, is that because there is this, I just mentioned it in passing, but we observe that there is this big difference. So historical technology, say in 1500, it's always a significantly associated with modern development or with modern technology, okay? But the migration flows of people, okay? And so in other words, when you look at the origin of the technology to which they were exposed, those that eventually populated a country, okay? And so this is particularly relevant when comparing Latin America to Africa, okay? So if you look at the levels of technology in Latin America, especially, you know, South America, prior to colonization, in our data set, the numbers are not very far apart from the numbers that you see in sub-Saharan Africa, okay? So, yes, they were slightly more advanced, the Mayas and the Aztecs, than certain tribes, certain civilizations in sub-Saharan Africa, but the distance was not very large in our indices, okay? So when you take into account the transfer of knowledge that happened with colonization in the analysis, when you look and you consider that in reality, the relevant level of technological know-how, historical technological know-how that you know, modern users of technology have been exposed are not the knowledge, the technological know-how that the Mayas and the Aztecs had, but because of the massive colonization and the transfer of people from especially southern Western Europe to many Latin American countries. The relevant technological know-how was that in southern Western Europe, then that helps you explain why in modern development between Latin America and sub-Saharan Africa.
Okay, so for a minute there was a little bump. So are you saying that the technological divergence is a result of Western technology in the Americas and not Mayan and Aztec technology?
Exactly. So the reason, if you look at our econometric results, you can explain the income differences today, the overwhelming majority of income differences today between Latin America and sub-Saharan Africa, by the inflow of technology that colonization brought to sub-Saharan Africa, to Latin America, sorry.
Okay then, so, the period of colonialism was shorter in Africa, but do you have any reason to suggest why the impacts on Africa are different?
Yes, so I think a great question, which I haven't spent that much time exploring, but I suspect that you're right. So first, the period of colonization in Africa was shorter, but also I'm not an expert in colonialism, okay? But my casual observation suggests that the much of the expansion to Latin America was was much more intense and much more it was expected to last longer than when European empires mostly conquer or colonize sub-Saharan Africa. Okay. In Spain, for example, the first railways was constructed in Cuba. It wasn't constructed in Spain. It was constructed in Cuba when Cuba was part of the Spanish Empire. Cuba was the richest region in Spain, and it was not seen as a place to go, exploit and then run away from it. It was seen as a place where there was really part of the Spanish Empire. So my feeling is that, and then this again, I'm not an expert on this, is that early colonizations were done probably with a different mindset than late colonizations in the 19th century, 18th, 19th century. But I'm not an expert. I don't have any particular. Study on this topic. It's actually a topic that, in the past I had some interest in diving into, but I've never done. So it could be, I cannot tell apart whether it's a matter of how long the Western empires stay in different parts of the world versus the timing, whether you went early on or later on.
All right. And in your research, do you identify that technology has a disparate impact? So, for example, are some technologies tremendously superior to others in predicting long-term economic growth?
I haven't explored that particular question. We tend to see. Sometimes, for example, in this exercise that we did in the paper with Bill and Eric, we look at whether the persistence that we see in technology is driven by any particular sector. We have the technologies classified in five broad sectors, and we see that the results are relatively symmetric across the different sectors. I don't think that I've seen any direct evidence that development is just achieved by one specific technology or by a few sets of technologies. Typically, you need to develop a know-how in a significant group of technologies that will have spillovers over future technologies. Having said that, more recent work that I've been doing in very different type of data, much more recent, suggests that there is certain path of expansion of technologies across different activities. And there are certain activities where firms tend to, whenever they want to improve their technology, they want to focus on these activities. And there are others where they tend to focus less. So it's true that though there is no silver bullet, there are technologies that drive development probably more than others. And so I think we are still in the infancy to answering that question.
All right then. And this was not covered by your research. It's just a question that I'm throwing out, and maybe you can test it yourself. But did the adoption of technology create a cultural preference for novelty? Is this a plausible area of research?
For novelty?
For example, because societies are accustomed to adopting technology over time, is there a cultural selection encouraging them to increase novelty? That's the question.
Yeah, I think that may be true. I mean, we see that places that are more resistant to places that have institutions that can be captured by some power, by some incumbents. Those places, it's easier to raise barriers to the adoption of technologies, okay? And so in a way, technologies, if they can be disruptive, they can shake out the status quo in terms of who is on top and who is on bottom from an economic standpoint, but also from a societal standpoint. So I think that, I mean, again, this is still a little bit speculative, but I think that you're right that places that are more prone to adopt technologies are places that are more eager to absorb new stuff, and they are more ready for change. I was just having lunch with somebody and we were talking about the Spanish labor market and why it's so hard for young people to find good jobs. And in part, that's because my hypothesis that that's because companies do not adopt technologies quickly. And so it takes a long time before they adopt them. And by then, the know-how of young people is not that relevant because the technologies that are adopted are old technologies, not new technologies. And so I think that's connected to your hypothesis.
Yes, because so for example, these innovations are disruptive. Therefore, to implement innovation, one must build social capital and create a culture of trust. So automatically, I do believe that countries with a longer duration of adopting innovation should be more innovative today. And again, your point in relation to property rights, that's quite poignant. Property rights promote the incentive to innovate, invest, and save. Countries with weaker property rights tend to be less innovative and have lower levels of institutional expertise. So I'm looking at the grand cultural picture. I'm quite interested in the evolution of cultures. I know cultures correlate with genes. So that's why I asked the question. And I would love to see more papers along this line.
Yes, there's been efforts by researchers. Romain Waxier they had some work where they would look at genetic distance between societies and development. And yes, that's not my field of expertise, but I'm not sure that we know very well how to separate genes from culture, from other things, but it's true that to some extent there is some connection between these different elements, some elements that have to do with our genes, our cultures, our know-how, technological exposure, all these things. And there are reasons to believe that they may be going hand in hand. And so we tend to force whole races between these different factors, but sometimes, they are complementary.
And another interesting point is that technologies make countries affluent, and affluence begets affluence. Scarcity begets scarcity. Affluent countries are more likely to innovate because they're accustomed to innovating and new creations, whereas people living in poorer countries often adopt a mindset that psychologists refer to as a fixed mindset. So again, this is another plausible area of research, and I like your paper. So are you going to take up the challenge?
Yeah, that's a provocative invitation. But I think you're right that income, I think it's an important factor in this thing. So I've always struggled to see how much income was driving technology as opposed to technology driving income. So, in a way, when it comes to studying technology, there are like three things that you can do. You can measure it, you can try to think what drives it, and you can try to look at what are the consequences of technology adoption. And so on the consequences, we always look at income, okay? So how much technology drives income. But one thing that you have to take into account is the impact of income on technology adoption. So without going to cultural transformations of societies, without going so deep as that, there is always an element that has to do with the fact that in places that are richer, there are more uses for technology. There's going to be more demand for the services and products that you produce with the new technology, especially if the technology leads to better stuff than what was produced before, okay? You know, it's always like a, you know, a luxury component to it. And so that's related to consumption theory, that's related to things that we have studied a lot when it comes to consumers buying more stuff when they are richer, that's called the Engel curve. And so those aspects, I think, you know, I've started to learn in recent years how to deal with them. More transcendental transformations of societies as you become richer, like, you know, like the ones that you were suggesting. Those, I think, I haven't thought about how to model them. I haven't thought about how to conceptualize them. But they're probably more interesting from an intellectual standpoint. They're more ambitious. Yeah.
Innovation is such a captivating topic because we do know that societies innovate, but why do some societies innovate in the first place? Why are some societies more receptive to technology? This is a different question from innovation.
Yes, I want to stress that. In particular, there is wars, there are certain wars that are very, very fuzzy and that we use them all the time. And so I want to stress the distinction between innovation and adoption or diffusion of technologies, okay? There are many places that are great at adopting technologies quickly that don't innovate at all, okay? They don't invent anything. They just implement whatever somebody else has invented. You know, I challenge you to tell me something that was invented in Singapore. And Singapore is, you know, one of the best countries in adopting technologies, implementing them, and becoming rich as a result. So there is, I think, and the US, for example, you know, I think without going to these exotic places in the US, there is also a great difference between certain companies that are extremely innovative, that they develop new products all the time, and they implement also new technologies that somebody else has invented, and other companies that it's not just that they don't innovate, because most companies in the world don't innovate at all, but that they really are behind in terms of the existing technologies. They don't adopt anything. So that's, you know, from a semantic perspective, that's an important distinction, especially when it comes to designing policies, because often policies that are directed to innovating, they are very hard to develop. They are very difficult to make them successful, and they are not going to lead, in most countries, they are not going to lead to much development, because innovating is very complex. While adoption, it's a different process that requires different policies, and which in a way is more attainable. And so from that perspective, when it comes to fostering development, especially in developing countries, there should be, I think, an emphasis on fostering the diffusion of technologies as opposed to fostering innovation.
I am glad that you brought up Singapore. Singapore is adept at incremental innovation. So, for example, Singapore had received award from the UN because of its work in sustainable development and eco-innovation. But at the same time, Singapore is not a space for radical innovations. And this could be linked to its culture. There's the innovation, individualism, and openness culture.
That's one possibility. The possibility is that really innovating is very complicated, and even though in Singapore they have spent billions of dollars in, for example, in fostering the pharma sector and developing, like, you know, biotech industry, not much innovation has taken place in Singapore, certainly not by Singaporean firms. While they have been extremely good, as you point, in improving on the margin, products that they learn how to produce, and by cutting corners and improving certain dimensions of these products, for example, in the electronic sector, in the chemical sector, they were able to jump to the forefront and to become a world class in some of these sectors in the past. So I think I agree with you. I'm not sure how much it's a matter of culture versus know-how, and I don't think there is anything wrong with the culture in Singapore. I've spent time living in Singapore. I think people there are fantastic. It's still entrepreneurial. It's just that it's hard to come up with, you know, radical innovation. That's not easy. There are many people many innovators in the US, many researchers, many entrepreneurs that come up with some of the brightest startups, that they are not American. They migrate to the US, and here they find the environment, the resources to develop these very innovative companies. So to which extent is that culture, or just being in the right environment to come up with all the stars that require being successfully innovating? I mean, it's pretty hard.
Look, Singapore has entrepreneurial know-how and human capital, but innovating is a long-term process. And in Western Europe and America, innovation has been a cross-cultural collaboration. So for example, a biologist can have an impact on engineering, on innovation in engineering, but Singaporeans believe that STEM is the way to engineering. STEM is very important. We need engineers and mechanics, but countries like America and England tend to focus on transferring skills across sectors. So for example, they're not going to discredit the knowledge of an anthropologist in economics. It's cross-cultural. So Westerners don't view innovation as a one-size-fits-all strategy. Someone with philosophy can start a company in Silicon Valley. Whereas in Singapore, students are told to study science, technology, engineering, mathematics, and become an innovator. They're not really taught to think more deeply. And I think this is an issue. Innovation historically has been a cross-cultural exercise, requiring several different professions and personalities. You cannot just assume that because one has a degree in engineering that he's going to become an innovator. That's not how it works.
No, I agree in part with that, not with everything. Like, you know, I think some of these best technologies have developed by people that are very narrow-minded, and they are, like, you know, they are focused on one thing. Many of them have been developed by engineers that knew nothing about philosophy, or by small teams, not by large teams. So, I mean, I think as you mentioned before, there is no one size fits all for innovation. Each innovation is different, or many of them are different. So the reason why there is not much innovation in places like Singapore, in addition to the fact that it's not a very large country, is probably multidimensional. And I'm not greatly in favor of cultural explanations for things. I guess that maybe that's the economist in me that—
You're not in favor of what type of explanation?
Cultural explanations for things. I mean, again, I think that maybe that's the economist in me that believes that when we have to resort to culture, it means that, you know, we have run out of explanations and we should go back to the drawing board. I'm not saying that culture is not important. I think it's very important for many things. But I personally haven't studied that much, so I wouldn't be comfortable making a claim that the reason why Singapore doesn't innovate is cultural. My feeling is that, you know, my explanation for that was that it's much harder to innovate than to adopt. And so adoption is something for which they have the right know-how. Innovation is a bit harder. And so, you know, for example, like there is this institution in Singapore called A-Star, who was providing to anybody that wanted to innovate, was providing all sorts of inputs, including, you know, advice, exposure to other knowledge, even IPs that they had in their portfolio. And I'm not sure how successful they have been on, for example, on developing medium-sized enterprises that they wanted to become exporters and to grow to the next level. So these things are hard to do from a governmental standpoint. They are difficult. I think that we don't know sufficient about these questions, but I agree with you, it's a fascinating question. Why certain places are more innovative than others? I'm not sure if the answer is the same as why there are differences in the adoption of technologies across countries. Both are quite complex, I have to grant you that. So,
yes. I've done research on A-Star. A-Star has assisted many entrepreneurs. Some of these businesses today are earning millions, but none of them are like Amazon or Microsoft. They're medium-sized businesses.
How many do we have like Amazon or Microsoft?
I mean, yes, exactly. But they tend to operate on a smaller scale. But A-Star actually has good data. You can just go on its website and it can give you a breakdown of its patents and case studies. Yeah, so I think technological know-how, entrepreneurial capital, and human capital are really important. But again, Singapore is a stable country. It's not, I will not call Singapore a dictatorship. Lee Kuan Yew would get very angry when people said that Singapore was not democratic. But Singapore is still trapped in that upper middle income Asian conformity, as I would call it. Innovation is messy. It is really, really messy. And to innovate, one must break the rules. And that type of culture is not fostered to a great degree in Asia.
Yeah, I mean, I think that, so maybe it's upper middle income, but it's very, very upper. It's much richer.
It's than high US. Income, sorry, not upper middle income. It's high income.
Yes, it's more upper than middle. But yeah, I mean, I think that when I look at Singapore, what I see is that I see significant external influence typically for better. So the transfer of technology from the US, especially. Maybe motivated by political reasons to some extent, in addition to the you know, idiosyncratic interest of multinationals that move there. And what I see today in Singapore is I see a very strong financial sector that makes it very attractive for local Singaporeans to work on finance, as opposed to, you know, which is a very, you know, I would say a relatively easy life, very, very well rewarded, as opposed to becoming scientists and engineers, which is a very complicated life, also rewarded, but much harder than to become a banker. I think one reason why Singapore probably is not as innovative as other places like, you know, like Taiwan or South Korea in a way, okay? Which are places where you don't have this strong financial sector because they are not the places where rich Asians deposit their wealth because of their stability, of the political stability. And so I think that to some extent there is a kind of a natural resource course, but with the financial sector that is making it harder for locals also to innovate or to become to the borderlines to something more productive than finance.
All right. So Diego, we're moving on to your second paper. If technology has arrived everywhere, why has income diverged?
Yes. So what do you want to know about it?
Yeah, so yeah, more countries are adopting technologies, even sophisticated technologies, but we're not seeing the radical gap between rich countries and poor countries shrinking.
Yes. So the idea is quite, it's connected to the other paper that you mentioned on chat, okay? So the idea is quite straightforward in a way. So what we try to do when we build chat is to measure technology diffusion in a way that would allow us to understand how the diffusion process changes over time. Most studies that we had until then would look at the diffusion of a particular technology over a few years for a few countries. And then it would be very hard to study changes in the diffusion process. What we did when we put together chat in this paper that you mentioned, which is a joint work with my co-author Martin Mestieri at the Chicago Fed, was to study how the diffusion process had changed over time. And we uncovered two facts which I find fascinating. I think these are really really staggering facts. The first one is that there is something called the adoption lag, okay, which is the time it takes from the moment in which a technology is invented to the moment in which it is adopted, okay. So it's a bit complex how we estimate that in the paper, because we don't model it, we don't measure that directly. We estimate it through a convoluted process. But the concept is relatively straightforward. Those adoption lags, they have been declining over time in the last two centuries. That's something that we saw in an earlier paper with Bart Hobain called An Exploration of Technology.
Yeah, we'll discuss that paper later.
Yeah, but the two are connected. So adoption lags have been declining. What we discovered with Marti in paper, if technology has arrived everywhere, why has income diverged, is that the decline in adoption lags, so adoption lags are long, okay? On average, for the technology that we look at, which is a sample of, I think, 25 technologies invented over the last 200 years, on average, adoption lags are like 40 years, okay? They are longer in poor countries, shorter in rich countries, but more importantly, and this is the fact that we found with PAR, is that adoption lags used to be very long. So older technologies invented, say, in the 18th, 19th century, those technologies had very long adoption lags. And those have been declining gradually over the last two centuries. So that technologies invented in the last 50 years, they have diffused quite quickly, okay? Now, what we found with Marti is that the rate at which adoption lags have declined is larger in poor countries, that is, in late adopters, okay? So in the old days, everybody used to adopt quite late, but much later, poor countries than rich countries, okay? That distance between the point at which countries adopt has narrowed gradually over the last 200 years, and today it's still the case that rich countries tend to adopt faster than poor countries, but technologies that are recently invented, the adoption lag is, the distance between rich and poor countries is quite small. So I'm not going to say it is negligible, but it's very, very small for historical standards. And so that's the motivation for the title. Like, if technology arrives everywhere and it arrives quickly, why is it the case that rich countries today are still so much richer than poor countries? Okay. And so that's the hook for the paper. The answer for the question is the following: is that when you start adopting a technology, it's just one dimension, one relevant dimension of the diffusion process. Okay, there is a second dimension which is very important, which is once you have fully adopted the technology, how intensively are you using it? Are you adopting it completely, or are you adopting it only halfway? Okay, and I'm being very loose. Adopting completely may mean that many people use the technology, or that companies that use the technology use it very extensively. They have many units of the technology in all the different divisions. While adopting it halfway may mean that few people adopt the technology, or that those companies or those people that use it only scarcely. They have little applications for the technology. Okay, that second margin of adoption, we call it the intensive margin of adoption. Okay, and it's very important because the more intensively you use a technology, a new technology, the larger the impact that the technology has on productivity, on the productivity of the country. Okay. So this second paper is really about understanding how technology diffusion changes over time, differently across countries, and how much that impacts the evolution of growth across countries, okay, over the last 200 years.
All right.
And so the second fact, so the first fact has to do with this reduction in adoption lags, and the fact that adoption lags have declined more in poor countries than in rich countries over the last 200 years. The second fact is that this intensity of use, which is higher in rich countries than in poor countries, it has become, the gap between rich and poor countries in this intensity of use has increased over the last 200 years. It has become, for newer technologies, the intensity at which new technologies are used eventually in rich countries is much larger than in poor countries, okay? So if you look at an old technology, the gap in this internal intensity of use between rich and poor is small relative to what it is today. And that's what drives the differences in productivity growth between rich and poor countries over the last 200 years. So if you look back at 1800, the gap between the average rich country and the average poor country in terms of productivity was less than a factor of three, okay? A rich country will have less than a factor of three productivity relative to the average poor country. Today, or in 2000, that gap was more than seven. It was around eight, okay? So it has almost tripled, okay? And so that's what explains basically this distance by a large extent. It can be explained by the evolution of the intensive margin. Approximately 80% of that.
All right.
Comes from the intensive margin.
So I get what you're saying, and the arguments sounds quite interesting, but I am fascinated by the triad of IQ, individualism, and openness to innovation. So for example, historically, the gap was smaller. Today, the gap is larger. There is a documented Flynn effect. More countries today than the past have higher IQs, but IQ is also linked to innovation, productivity, and openness to ideas. Intelligent people will find more uses for technologies. So could this be explained by the IQ gap between rich and poor countries?
I haven't studied IQ differences across countries. I suspect that this must be a very controversial
research, exactly.
Topic. And so precisely because of that, I wouldn't like to make any comment about it. Because first, I haven't studied, and second, whatever I say is going to lead to some controversies.
Yes.
So going back to your question, I haven't done much work about explaining these trends in diffusion. I suspect that the reduction in adoption lags and the larger reduction in poor countries than in rich countries probably has to do with the fact that now, in a way, knowledge flows more across countries. There are multinationals traveling over the world and bringing new technologies faster to people. And there's, you know, the new technologies, they require relatively low barriers to entry, okay?
Okay.
However, once the technology has arrived to a country, how intensively it's used, that depends on the opportunities we have to use the technology, on how sophisticated the know-how to utilize the technology is. And if, as we saw in the paper with Bill and Eric on was the Wealth of Nations Determined in 1000 BC, if there are these dynamics by which previous technology adoption leads to more know-how, more knowledge acquired by, you know, the people that live in a country that facilitates the adoption of subsequent technologies, if those processes are present, I suspect that will lead to a potentially divergence in the intensity of use, okay? But this is all quite speculative. I mean, it is, I think, a fascinating challenge to try to explain why there is divergence in the intensity of use and convergence in the extensive margin. One thing I did many years ago with Martínez theory, you know, when we started working, was to look at some data on when the first schools were created in different fields in each country, okay? And it turned out that places that created earlier certain schools, say in engineering or in naval studies or in agriculture, those schools that were relevant for certain technologies, that the date of creation would predict the intensity of use of the relevant technologies 150 years later, okay? And so that, I mean, just anecdotal evidence, so to speak, but suggests that these knowledge spillovers may be relevant. And in other words, that a purely knowledge-based explanation might help you explain some of the variation that we see in the intensity of use of new technologies today in rich versus poor countries. However, I'm sure that this doesn't explain the entire thing. I'm completely sure, because the variation is huge. So, you know, I don't know if variation IQs is going to be the right explanation. I've never looked at it,
but some researchers are interested in the topic, quite a few. Unfortunately, and I say unfortunately because the people who have done the better research in the field, or the individuals who are interested in research in the field, are very old, and many of them have died. Yes.
Okay, yes.
Yes. Only few young people are brave enough to pick up this topic. But for example, David Landes is dead. But the type of people who would do the research that David Landes is interested in are no longer with us, unfortunately, because we now have a surplus of data on culture. And I just can imagine David writing a new book to be published in 2022, but unfortunately, he died. But no one will take up that task. So we can talk about the third paper you wrote, An Exploration of Technology Diffusion.
Yes. So that paper is actually contemporaneous to the first one we discussed. We basically, different co-authors, but I work on both of them approximately at the same time. And the idea was to try to come up with a new way to measure technology that will allow me to cover comprehensively the diffusion process for many countries and many technologies. And so most existing data sets at the time were based on firm level data, micro level data. And that was great because it would provide lots of detail about the adoption process at the firm level. But it was not very operative. It was not easy to use those data because in order to be able to have a comprehensive process of adoption across many countries and a comprehensive understanding of the adoption process across many countries and across many technologies, you need to have and collect data from each firm in each different country, in each different time period for each different technology. So it was not a very promising way to proceed. So what we did with Barhobain was to try to collect information at the country level. And this is where CHAT came from. So CHAT allowed us to characterize graphically the diffusion of new technologies across countries. And based on that, you know, we built this understanding that there are these two dimensions of the adoption process. The first is this extensive margin. The second one has to do with this intensive margin, but at the time we didn't name it, we didn't make anything out of it. And so this paper on an expression of technology diffusion, what it does is it focuses on this extensive margin, on these adoption lags, and characterizes how are these adoption lags for a group of technologies, for a group of countries, a large group of countries. And that's basically what the paper does. You know, it explores how much variation there is across countries and over time in these adoption lags. It shows that adoption lags are large. They are small for poor countries, for rich countries, sorry, large for poor countries, and they account for approximately 25% of income differences. That's the big number that comes from this study.
No, Diego, we're not going to delve into this paper because we're planning to wrap up. The paper is titled The Spatial Diffusion of Technology. Over, we will talk about it. Diego, why are the effects of cultural distance so persistent?
Yes. So that's a different paper. So that's
paper. We're not going to talk about it. We're really going to fixate on cultural distance and the adoption of technology. Why is there a link? Yes. Why is it so persistent?
So we look in that paper at the effects of distance. We use geographic distance, and we acknowledge that geographic distance might be a proxy for other distances, like, you know, genetic distance or cultural distances, or, you know, distances that have to do with historical past. But we never look at what's the role of these different variations. So it could be that I adopt technologies faster because you are my neighbor and you have lots of experience or lots of units of a particular technology, or it could be that I adopt technologies faster because we are my neighbor and we share a common culture, or we have more elements in common in our culture. So in that paper with let me cite my co-author, with Esteban Rossi from Princeton and with Mikhail Dmitriev from Florida State University. In that paper we explicitly attempt not to dive into what these distances reflect exactly, and we leave that for other researchers. But I think that the reason why these distances matter, is because technology is sticky. Technology is not just information. It's not like something that you post and then people can see from all over the world. Technology is something that has to do with a set of rules and understandings that are difficult to transmit verbally or digitally. And so you need to get physical with technology in order to develop an understanding of how to use it. And that's why distance matters. That's the long answer to your very specific question.
Yes, and as I said earlier, the spatial diffusion of technology, that's the name of the paper, and your co-authors are from Boston College and Princeton University. We only discussed it briefly, but before I go, I have not seen a paper covering this topic, but I'm going to ask the question. Are rich countries more likely to create derivative innovations? So for example, when an innovation is created, are rich countries likely to create spin-offs of that innovation?
I think that in general, I mean, the way we define innovation is quite science-based, okay? So innovation, you know, you can define it as something very specific, very related to science, or it can be something very broad. The more science-based is the definition of innovation, or the way you narrow it, the more it circumscribed, to rich countries. There are very few innovations that take place outside rich countries. There are innovations that are extremely creative and valuable that take place in poor countries, often directed at adapting or implementing technologies in a way that is closer to their needs. And those are extremely valuable innovations, but they are, as you would say, you know, spin-offs. They are like applications of something that has been developed somewhere else, and they are trying to implement, like, you know, a poor man's version that works better for them, and so it has a great value. But the majority, like both radical as well as, you know, derivative or incremental innovations, those typically they are developed, most of them in rich countries.
All right, thanks. That's all I wanted to know. So we're wrapping up now. But before I go, Diego, it was a pleasure speaking to you. I thoroughly enjoyed the conversation. And will you be researching any of the questions I have posed?
Well, I would love to. I think that often we don't research the questions that we would like to research, but those that we believe that we would be able to accomplish more or less successfully given the high standards that we have in, you know, in science.
Yes.
So I have to, you know, I'm very glad to acknowledge that all of the ideas that you throw on the table, they are, you know, fantastic topics for research.
But too controversial.
No, I think that some of them are interesting. I think some of them would be extremely interesting if the right data and the right methods were in place. Developing those data and those methods, it's not trivial at all.
It's very hard.
But I would, let me promise you the following, Lipton. I'm going to review the video, and I'm going to take notes of your ideas, put them on a book note, and at some point I will revisit them and try to see if I can make progress with any of them.
Okay? All right, bye. But if you get canceled, that's not my fault.
That's fine.
All right. Okay.
Nice talking to you. Thank you very much for the interview.
It was a pleasure. All right.
Take care. Bye-bye.